Greetings everyone, ZXSS here, and this is going to be the start of my first of my all-purpose reviews. Now my channel has now switched over to basically me being the gamer of all generations, and I'm reviewing everything. And first off, it's a PC indie title, going by the name of 1953 KGB Unleashed. Shall we see what this one entails? Developed by Fantomery Interactive. 1953 KGB Unleashed is described as a tense atmospheric adventure set in an old Soviet bunker during the Cold War. It must be freezing down there if you ask me. Players must uncover the dark and horrific secrets buried within. Sounds good, right? But as per usual, this is an indie game, so no AAA backing up here. And how does the game hold out? Well, to tell you the truth, I've got two minds here. The game excels in some areas, the game dips in some areas. But we'll explore this a bit more. The game has its ups and downs, but let's delve a little deeper into this. The game itself is a first-person point-and-click adventure. Well, what do you do with that one? You just point and click your mouse and, lucky enough, you spin it around. Yes, a first-person one as well. It's not the first time it's been done before, and I know it's been done before, but for the like of me, I can't remember. So you're not going to see anything particularly new with this, but hey, they give it a good shot. From the start of the game, you get some nice footage from 1953 Russia, just so it can get you in the feel for the period, and just generally add a little bit more to the game's authenticity of when the setting actually was. Before dropping down into a bunker, where you see this wonderful, wonderful shot of our protagonist here. And it seems to be coming from being out from unconscious stupor. Either he's been kidnapped or he's been... No, I'm not going to mention a drunk reference of vodka. That's just been stereotypical. But how would you end out in a concealed bunker through a through a wild night of drinking would be beyond me. But anyway, somehow he fell into this weird place. But if there's something to do with the KGB, you know he didn't get dropped in there through a drunken stupor. There should be all sorts of things happening. Now, this comes along, and here is my first gripe with the game. You can hear the commentary of the protagonist, you can hear him talking while he walks around the bunker with the ever-changing situation, but the problem is he's talking perfect English. Now, I know Fantomery Interactive is a Russian software company themselves, and of course they program out of Russia. And to give you the truth and honesty, I would have loved to have heard a Russian accent on the character. Come on, the game is set in the Russian homeland. You're playing a Russian character. Why can't he have a Russian accent? I'm pretty sure they wouldn't have offended anybody. Like I said, come on, the guy's in his homeland. He's speaking perfect English. You might need to change the story and make him believe he was some sort of soldier. But no, come on, the guy's a local. A Russian accent would have just been perfect for this. But as you play through the game, and various other medias like radio stations and various other things, they all have Russian-based music and Russian-based speech and everything else like this. Why does this guy speak perfect English? I know I'm being picky here, but like I say, a more Russian accent on the character would have gone a long way. Hell, even a full Russian language with subtitles would have been good. English subtitles. But, nah, they could have worked it a little bit here and given us a slight Russian accent just to give a little bit more feel of the authenticity with this. But it's a minor sort of thing. Now also, the game also came to be based upon real information on real projects that were supposed to have been performed by the KGB during the Cold War scenario. These on part included people being pushed to extreme limits of their endurance, and also possibility of phenomena like telepathy and a investigation into the fear and its psychological impacts it had on the brain. Some really, really strange stuff, but it's this which helps it build a great atmosphere for the game. Whether it was using proper KGB documents, it could have been. This could have been something that could have been declassified information. I'm not quite sure. Because it was done by a Russian studio, I would hope there was some authenticity in this, because it would make for a great feel on this one. Like all sorts of games in this field, I'm talking about the likes of Myst, Riven, well, they're both done by the same company. The game blends explorations and puzzles into the thing. Now, unfortunately, this is another where one of the faults comes into the game. The game is not very big in its physical size. It's in essence, it's really quite small. When you do see a lot of the other games out and about, and they have very, very large scale adventures and multiple locations, you're in the confines of a very secluded bunker, and it's not a very big one either. I would have liked some more eerie effects on walking around corridors, but that's something else that comes along. But like I say, it's small in size, but it does what it needs. You can't really post about it. How else would you picture a bunker? A bunker is actually a small item as well. But I'm kind of delivering off and going on to bloody architectural things here. but let's just move on there. But also for the size of the game, if you don't know what you're doing, it will take you a good few hours. If you do know what you're doing, you could probably clear the game out in a speed run in about 2 to 3 hours. Maybe shorter if you don't make any flops and if you really know the game back to front and you know how to do everything without the need of picking up the documentations. But the first playthrough will take you for a little bit because you need to work out the puzzles, work out where they are as well. The puzzles are spread throughout the bunker, and a lot of them either require you to have an item to progress onwards, or through the fact of reading documentation, which is practically strewn about everywhere. There's a lot of documentation for a small game like this to be read, and a lot of them provide with clues on how to solve some of the puzzles. Into solving the puzzle itself, there's a very scarce lack of a few things. One, the items that are used for solving the puzzles are not clearly set out. Going over games like The Seventh Guest, there was always like an indication that there was a puzzle here that you're going to have to solve. Unfortunately, this game lacks that feature in a very big way. You could possibly guess by if you click on certain items, and there is if you could sit there and play with the item, then you could pretty much guess that this has got something to do this one. But then again, if you are looking for a challenge and something that's going to make your head spin, and not by looking at a thing, this will satisfy your needs quite nicely because you really have to look out. Some of the puzzles may require multiple items, some of them may require multiple documents to actually solve. Then, because I know one thing is the radio puzzle needs several documents which tell you exactly where to tune into, what frequency to use. So you need to keep your eye about while you're looking for these sorts of stuff. But to keep things a little bit more simplistic on the side of that one, they don't have any puzzles that require you to combine the few items that you do have in the game. So it does keep it less cryptic. There's no need to combine a pencil and a reel of tape or anything like that. So you all items have one use, one purpose. So you're not going to be confused on a lot of the sort of stuff. But what I did find myself personally is when I started working out what went where and what parts of it's done, then the rest of the puzzle seemed to fall into place quite neatly. So they are planned. Once you start working at it, you can then get the information you need, and then you can also find the answer to the solutions. Also, the game does get you to scour about every inch of the room while you're exploring with a mouse cursor, because there are some items you need, and they could be in a simple sort of case. They could be right underneath your nose, and you'd pass over them several times if you're going around in a hurry. And then you'll go back and you'll find the item. You're like, phew, it was right in front of your face, and you saw it so many times but didn't quite click on it. The infantry system is handled quite simply. Simply click the right button to make your infantry appears. Your stuff's in the bottom left-hand corner. There's a quick access to your files in the top right-hand, top left-hand corner, and in the bottom right, you have access to your save and options, the very few that there is. But let's get into what I really liked about the game, and that's the atmosphere. The atmosphere is brilliant. It really gets you in a place where you feel enclosed and paranoid and ooh, small details add to it even more. First of all, the music to the game is brilliant. While not being typical style Russian music for the time, the music does have an impact and feels like in place. It's got a great sense and it always plays just at the right times, just when you're getting relaxed and everything like that. Something then pops up and keeps you on your toes. It makes you feel, whoa. And it just keeps, you start to feel safe and then the music plays and then you then start creeping out. And I tried playing this game at midnight and it really, really did spook me some certain times when I was basically going around this bunker. Try it for yourself. Switch the lights off and play this game in the dark. Trust me, it will scare the pants out of you. And yeah, the atmosphere is just done beautifully. The game itself doesn't use jump scares at all. There's nothing which is going to jump out of you and go bleh, or anything else like that. It's plays on your mind, especially when you get later on. It gets to keep you on your edge. And that's what the game does well. It knows exactly how to restrict you. It exactly knows when you're going to get let through. You can't gain full access to the whole bunker straight off. You need to solve the puzzles that's been done. And these need to be done piece by piece. And once you go for one puzzle you need to solve, there, if you stay in the area too long, you basically start hocking and coughing your guts out. It forces you to leave the area until you could get down long enough to find out what's stop making you do this, and you work a way around to clear the area, which is good. And then you also need to find various other antidotes. Like I say, these things are a lot of time guesswork. There's not very much in telling you exactly what's going on. Some items you may pick up may give it away. It's a very different thing. And if you really want to get creeped out by this, especially later on when you go down into the bay, right down into the deep of the bunker. There's just little things they do which really keep you on edge and really make you go, what the? Yeah, it's that sort of game and it can really keep you going in a lot of aspects. And let's say, if you're brave enough, play it in the dark. If you're not, I still felt creeped out playing it in broad daylight, put it this way. But its atmosphere is second to none. It's done really, really well and I'm super impressed with the way it's done. The graphics themselves are nothing super duper. Smash you in the face. Ah, it's going. There's not even any video options in the game anyway. The game uses simple point-and-click adventure. We're not talking ball-busting physics stuff here. One you're going to need a fucking top-of-line graphical monster card to do. It just runs on simple mechanics, and it looks okay. It doesn't sit there and demand off you. So even a weaker machine can run this. And even though the game uses a 360 as you're moving around, these are 3D areas. I probably could have thought the use of the WASD keys could have been a bit more of a usage, but it doesn't happen, unfortunately. That would have been a really, really nice touch to the whole game if you do it that way, but no, you have to move your mouse cursor into position before you move to the next section. You can't have it all, let's put it this way. It's still. Yeah, I know. It just seems daft, but it's just the way it is. They could have done it in a full 3D, but they chose not to have any reason why. But hey, 1953 KGB Unleashed is a solid but very short pointy clicker adventure game. While it does get a bit confusing on the puzzle aspects, it does maintain its light. It does maintain its go with a very, very good atmosphere to the game. And I do really enjoy a good atmosphere, this one. It kept me creepy and it kept me coming back into this one. It's just made you look into that fear of the unknown that little bit more. And it also made you read stuff and also made you look for those small details, which is very, very good. The short lifespan is the downside to the game. It is pretty short, shorter than most other point-and-click adventure games. It has a £7 price tag on Steam. I do believe that's a little too much. I would say grab it when it goes on maybe 50% on a sale or something like that. But I do reckon the company in themselves do need your money. But I don't think the price tag they were asking for it was is worth what they ask. The company has also said they actually didn't get very much money return on the title, which is a shame. The title in itself had a lot of potential in the point and click market. And this game does prove it. They know how to tell a good story. They know how to set a good atmosphere. They didn't really need to do much to make this game any spookier than what it was. But it can be pushed a little bit more, I could have reckoned. If they probably would have had enough time, or they could work a little bit more on it, they could have done. Now, I actually visited the software company's website, and thanks to Google Translate, I managed to get a look in there. Found the game that was originally called Phobos 1953, and they also had another game which they did called Sublustrum, and it was released outside Russia as Outcry. If I could find a copy of that game, I'd also like to take a look at this too, because I enjoyed this game with its faults. And I would like to see what else they did and see if this Outcry used the same sort of style. If it did, then I'll be in for something good. Just on a side note, also after poking around on their website, the game was also supposed to be a prequel to a film that was actually made in Russia called The Phobos, which is basically a modern-day nightclub which is set to happen to be above an underground bunker, and where people coinciding get trapped in the bunker and... Yeah, starting to sound familiar to you? It's got a similar sort of thing to this one, but they just did it in a film format. I don't know if the film got released outside of Russia or anything else like that, but maybe worth seeing if it ever did. If it got a Russian subtitle, an English subtitle, or even an English dub. Hey, you never know. Let's go in room. But, like I say, if you just love the coincidence of that, then that's fair be. So fair dues to fair play to this game. Like I said, it's a short point and click adventure. But it's a good one in some aspects. I feel that a few more clues could have been done to help this game along. But all in all, I'd say if you get to see it in a sale, grab it. If you're a point-and-click adventure fan, I don't think you'll be disappointed. Anyway, ZXSS finished here, and this was my first go. So hopefully you've enjoyed this more lengthy interview compared to some of my old previous ones. Interview? Review? compared to some of my previous shorter ones. And I hope I've given you enough information to make a decision if you reckon this game will be worth your time or not. Anyway, see you all soon. Bye-bye.